Passover. Passover is one of seven annual feasts. And we typically like to refer to these as the Feast of Israel, and I find that unfortunate. Because as soon as we do that, you who are non-Jewish believers, and note the way I say that, non-Jewish believers, most people in churches call themselves a Gentile Christian. Do you know what Gentile means? Pagan. How'd we ever come up with the idea of a pagan Christian? It's the biggest oxymoron going. So you're either a Jewish believer or a non-Jewish believer. It's just that simple. So you who are non-Jewish believers are sitting here thinking, you know, come on now. We're not Jewish. What could this possibly have to do with us? Well, the fact of the matter is in Leviticus 23, where God establishes these seven annual feasts, in verse 2 of that chapter, God himself does not refer to these as the Feast of Israel, but the Feast of the Lord. If you're saved tonight, that's your Lord. Same Lord that owns you owns these feasts. So it would be well for you to understand these and how they do pertain to your walk before this Jewish Messiah, Yeshu, Jesus. Now, there are seven of these. They required three trips a year to the temple up until 70 AD, since then to the synagogues around the world. Now, this was only required of the men and of the boys, not the ladies, not their daughters. First trip came in the spring of the year, covers an eight-day period in the first three feasts, which is Passover, followed immediately by unleavened bread, culminating with the Feast of First Fruits. Now, First Fruits is the feast upon which Jesus rose from the dead, not Easter. We don't celebrate Easter. You think, well, you need to stick around here for Sunday morning. I promise whatever it is you're gearing up for, Easter is not what you're celebrating. And I'll clear that up in a little bit. The second trip comes 50 days later. That's the Feast of Pentecost. The third and the final trip of the year comes in the fall of the year. It covers a 22-day period, the last three of these feasts. We call them the High Holy Days, Trumpets, Atonement, Tabernacles. Now, every one of these seven annual feasts very clearly foreshadows and is fulfilled by Jesus himself. None more thoroughly than Passover. From this table tonight, I'm going to show you Jesus in every possible way you could hope to see him. From his virgin birth, his death, his burial, his resurrection, his second coming, millennial kingdom reign. I will show you where Jesus lifts from this table and gave us what we know to be the Lord's Supper. Now, of all these seven annual feasts, my people consider Passover to be their crown jewel. I like that. They can't tell you why they esteem this feast so highly, but I like the fact that the feast which most thoroughly depicted Jesus just happens to be our crown jewel. Now, there are a lot of reasons why you need to understand this feast, not the least of which, friend, listen, our Savior is a Jew, born of the line of the tribe of Judah to be seated on David's throne to rule and reign forever. God's holy word is a Jewish book. It's written by Jews, to Jews, about a Jew. Now, I just like to throw this one out there. You may think there's some heresy in this one. Nice thing about it is you can't prove me wrong. Not on this side of heaven anyway, because if I am wrong, we won't know till we get there, and then guess what? Yeah, and you're going to have to forgive me. No Baptist grudges in heaven, folks. It's just not going to happen. You remember Matthew 26, Jesus is in that upper room. He's just partaken of that broken loaf of matzah, that third cup of wine. He took these elements, put them down, and then declared, I'll not eat of this bread nor drink of this cup again until I take it with you anew when I come into my Father's kingdom. It could very well be that what Jesus was alluding to was that marriage supper of the Lamb... Boy, I hope you're praying that'll be soon. That very well could be this feast. I can't think of a feast more fitting to observe in that day than the one which most thoroughly depicted what placed us at that table in the first place. So again, if I'm wrong, we won't know till we get there. I'm just counting on you to forgive me. As we approach the table, sundown, the 14th of the month of Nisan, according to Leviticus 23, Exodus 12, and of course the Jewish calendar, you need to appreciate the fact that up until 70 AD, there really was only one place on all the earth that you could legitimately observe this feast. And that would have been the temple in Jerusalem. But we no longer have the temple. It was destroyed by Titus of Rome in 70 AD, along with the city of Jerusalem. The city's been rebuilt, not the temple. Now, personally, I believe God himself orchestrated those events that brought about the destruction of the temple. And I believe that for this reason. If the temple were standing still today, my people would continue to perform those sacrifices that Hebrews tells us can never take away sin. And the focus never would have shifted from the blood of goats and bulls and lambs to this one man, who after offering himself one time for many, is now seated at the right hand of the Father, ever to make intercession for you and for me. So personally, I believe God himself orchestrated those events that brought about the destruction of the temple, that put an end to the sacrificial system, which meant its fulfillment in Jesus Christ when he went to the cross of Calvary. Now, that being as it is, we now observe this feast in the homes of Jewish families the world over. Now, this feast represents righteousness, holiness, purity. So we have to prepare the house in a very special fashion in order to receive this holy and righteous feast. So what we're going to do is we're going to go through a little ritual called purging out the leaven. Leaven in Scripture, I think, in all but one instance represents sin. And you know, it doesn't take a lot of sin to make us sinners. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump, the Bible tells us. Fact of the matter is, all we need is to be born of Adam's seed, and we're sinners in need of one to come and do for us what we can never do for ourselves, and the Bible is filled with this. In sin was I conceived, in sin my mother brought me forth. All we like sheep have gone astray. There is none righteous, no, not one. All our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And I think it reaches its pinnacle when we read in Romans 5 and verse 12 that because Adam sinned, death came, and death passed to all men because all have sinned. So we're all in the same boat. We're all desperately in need of one to come and do for us what we could never do for ourselves and provide that atoning work of grace. So what we're going to do now is purge out that old leaven. Everybody in the family is going to get involved in this. I mean, we're going to clean this house literally within an inch of its life, like it never gets clean any other time of the year. Remember, we're in the spring of the year. Any of this sound familiar, ladies? Yeah. I was in one church, somebody yelled out, wrong generation. With that little spring cleaning torture you've been inflicting on your household all these years, where do you suppose that came from? If not from preparing the house to receive this holy and righteous feast, and that being in the spring of the year. Well, once we've done that, my father would play a little game with his kids. He'd take some crumbs of bread, some crumbs of cake, anything that had leaven in it, hide it in places where the kids would be likely to find it. He'd put it under the doormat, under a seat cushion, on the bookshelf. My father then would give each of us kids a candle, and I can remember he'd light that candle for us, send us out throughout the house to search for the leaven. Now, when we found the leaven, we left it alone. We called on our father, who came with a wooden spoon and a white feather, and he'd sweep that leaven into that wooden spoon, cast that into the fire, and it would be burned away. If there's no fire in the house, he'd cast it from the house, and now the house is deemed to be free from leaven, able to receive this holy and righteous feast. This reminds me of something very important, though. According to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, every last one of us who knows Jesus as our personal Savior will one day stand before Him and give an account. That passage tells us the sum total of our life is cast in that fire. The things which we did that brought honor and glory to our Savior are characterized as gold, silver, precious stone. They'll be added as jewels to our crowns, but don't you get too attached to those crowns. We'll be casting those at Jesus' feet. Somebody asked me, so why would God have me work for rewards I don't even get to keep? Well, I think Paul covers that when he tells us that no flesh should glory in his presence. Unfortunately, while we're going to be pretty enamored watching these things, we're going to see some other things of our life cast in that fire at the same time. These are the things which we did that did not bring glory to our Savior. They're characterized as wood, hay, stubble. They'll be burned away, lost for all of eternity, and there'll be no reward for these. Now, usually when I get to this spot, people's minds will run to the sinful, wicked things we still may do once we've been saved. So what about that soul that you recently witnessed to? And they got saved. But you spent so much time glorifying yourself that there was no glory for Jesus. See, he's not going to share our spotlight, folks. And in that very scenario, Jesus warns us, don't think you have a reward in heaven. We have it on earth, and we've squandered it. I just want to provoke our thinking a little bit. Saddest part of this whole passage, it goes on and tells in that day there are those standing there, and it's all wood, hay, and stubble. These will not have done one single thing since being saved that brought honor and glory to the Savior, that gave us all to snatch them out of the fires of a burning hell, set their feet on streets of purest gold, make them citizens of heaven, children of the living God for all of eternity, not one single thing. I mean, you'd think just gratitude would force you to do something. Obviously, there are those that will escape this. Now, they'll still be saved. That passage tells us, yet so is by fire. They will have just escaped hell, and that's all. And I find this to be a horrible prospect, and one we desperately need to guard against in our walk before the Lord in this life on this earth. Well, once we've done this, and we deem the house to be free from leaven and able to receive this holy and righteous feast, sundown, the 14th of the month of Nisan, we'd begin to take our place around the table. Now, you need to understand this table. Everything on this table is unique to Pesach. Nothing will be used at any other time of the year. We have a white linen table cover. White represents righteousness, holiness, purity, which is what the feast depicts. We have white candles, which bring light to our feast, which otherwise would be in darkness. The number of these fluctuate according to how many you have at your table. This table is set up for two, so I have two candles. In the home I grew up in with five children and my parents, there'd be seven. So you can see how that works. There's a Seder plate in the middle of the table. It has symbolic foods. I'll explain those as we go along. There's a book called the Haggadah, the story of our deliverance. Father, we'll use the Haggadah, recall that story, employ these foods on the Seder plate. There's a cup of wine at every place at the table. There are four cups of wine involved in Passover. I'll explain these as well. There's a platter of matzah. Matzah is unleavened bread. It's flat because it has no leaven. It's striped from the cooking grid. It's pierced with holes. These can't be chipped or broken. They have to be perfect in every way. These are used during the ceremony of the bread, as is the matzah tash, which is a linen envelope that has three compartments to it. There's also a white linen napkin provided for that ceremony of the bread as well. There's a place setting at every place at the table. Remember, we were taught not only to sacrifice that lamb and apply the blood, but we were to roast it and eat it in its entirety that night and leave nothing till morning. So the very large festive meal observed at Passover, these dishes are very important. The proper kosher housewife, ladies, doesn't keep just one set of dinnerware in her home for everyday use, maybe a second set for company. She must at all times maintain in her home at least four complete sets of dinnerware. See, she can never put meat on a dish she had ever put a dairy product on. Can't wash them together in the same water, not really even in the same sink. So you need two complete sets of dinnerware for everyday use, one set dedicated meat products, another set dedicated dairy. If you have a set of china, you'll have two, one for meat, one for dairy. Then you need two more complete sets of dinnerware reserved solely for your Passover table, dedicated after the same fashion. Now, if these are used at any other time of the year, even by accident, you know, Junior comes in starving to death, as he always is, right? Gets in the cupboard, pulls out some dishes, gets some food out of the refrigerator. He's sitting at the kitchen table enjoying himself. Mom comes in and discovers Junior got into her Passover dishes. Well, after she's recovered, she'll destroy these, the entire set, and go out and purchase another set to replace them. See, they've been defiled now. They're not fit for use under any circumstance. I just need you to see how strongly these things are adhered to. Now, there's an extra place setting at the table. I told you this table was set up for two candlesticks, but there's a third place setting. It doesn't matter how many you have at your table, you always set this extra spot. There'd be a chair here with a cushion, a place setting, a cup of wine. This is reserved solely for Eliyahu the prophet, who my people believe will come on Passover and Passover night alone. And they expect him to come to every Jewish household around the world on this one night and announce to every Jewish family, Messiah has come. So, he's on a long, difficult journey this night. Now he's in our home. Proper customs of hospitality demand that we take care of him. So we have a chair here with a cushion so he can relax, a place setting so he can be nursed, a cup so he can be refreshed. No, by the way, ever wonder where this notion of setting out cookies and milk for Santa ever came from? Who else is said to be schlepping the entire world one night a year, popping in on everybody's home, invited or not, and just might need a little nosh, a little snack? We had it first, okay? Year after year after year, no one ever sits in this seat, eats from that plate, drinks from that cup. Friend, listen, this prophet's already come. This announcement has already been made. It shouldn't be too great a shock to your system for me to remind you tonight that Jesus, in fact, was not born December 25th. I said that one church, all the heads in unison popped to the pastor. Mouths fell open, eyes bulged out. I said, brother, what did I say? We went out to dinner afterwards. I said, okay, what did I say? He said, well, I just finished a series of messages proving he had. Well, he's still my friend. Church still supports us. And you know the way I look at it, as long as that check keeps rolling in, he can be as wrong as he wants to be. Fact of the matter is, the gospel record gives us some time locators so that we can understand some things. Because of Zacharias being a Levitical priest in the temple, burning the incense, lighting the lamps, there's such a rigid course and order to this. And he probably waited his entire lifetime for his opportunity to fill this role, and they kept such copious records. And it was at that moment that the angel came to him and declared to him that his wife Elizabeth had conceived and would bear him a son who would be John the Baptist. Because of all this, we can pretty well pinpoint when that took place. You start dating forward from that moment. You come to the birth of John the Baptist in the spring of the year at the time of the Passover. Now, Jesus, who humanly speaking was 6 months younger than John, would then have been born in the fall of the year. But what I need you to see is no Jewish man ever began his public ministry until his 30th birthday. So watch John the Baptist at his 30th birthday in the spring of the year at the time of the Passover. At the only time of the year my people ever expect this announcement to have been made, and there he is in the spirit of Elijah declaring Messiah had come. And this, in a nutshell, is the urgency of our ministry. My people still have difficulty grasping this truth. And it's our responsibility to get this message of the things that they're begging for, and clamoring for, and pleading to God for, that he would bring this prophet to announce the coming of Messiah, that he in fact has already fulfilled that in the person of John the Baptist, who came in the spirit of Elijah and made that declaration and did it at the only time of the year that they were expecting it to have been made. So keep us in your prayers as we continue to pursue our ministry among my people. As Father comes to the table, he can wear one of two garments. I'll show both to you. The first garment, while it's acceptable, is not the desired garment for Passover. This is the tallis, the prayer shawl. We were taught in Scripture that we were to sew the fringes upon the borders of the garment. This then is the garment that was designed for that purpose. The fringes represent God's promises to my people. No Orthodox Jewish man will ever be without this garment in some form or fashion. This is his ability to pray. You may see Jewish men not wearing the entire tallis, the prayer shawl, but you'll see the fringes that sits as exposed at their waistband. They're wearing another form of this under their vest, under their shirt, exposing the tzitzis. Now they can pray. I've seen Jewish men sometimes these days just tying the tzitzis to their belt loops, and that seems to be sufficient. But you know, I see Jesus wearing this garment very clearly in the Word of God. Do you remember when Jesus was walking through the city streets and the crowds enthronged him, and a woman showed up on this particular day in a crisis situation in her life, desperately needing to approach Jesus, but couldn't get close enough to him because there were too many people? So what did she do? She came up from behind him, she reached out, and she did what? Touched the hem of his garment. Look what she reached for in her crisis. Remember when Jesus said, when you go into your prayer closet, close the door? This is what he has in mind. See, I wasn't raised with the same advantage that you've been raised with. Wasn't raised to believe that when I prayed, God would respond. I mean, why should he? You remember how astonished David was at this notion? He cries out to God, "What is man that thou art mindful of him?" Elsewhere, the psalmist tells us that God condescends to look upon the heavens. Well, if it's beneath God for him to look upon the heavens, how much more so for him to look upon me? So I will cover myself in my tallis, clutch onto his promises, go to him in prayer with absolutely no assurance whatsoever that he's going to respond. I mean, why should he? But he ought to respond to these. Now, last month marked 48 years since I trusted Jesus as Messiah and got saved. Can you imagine how excited I get, even to this very moment, when I so much as think of those words in Hebrews that tell me that because of everything that Jesus did for me on the cross of Calvary, I can come boldly to the throne of grace and find help and mercy in my time of need. I don't have to worry about whether or not he'll hear me when I pray. I know as any father longs to hear the voice of his son, my heavenly Father longs to hear me coming to him in prayer and longs to give me every good and every perfect gift that he can. Well, the garment that is most desired for Passover is known as the kittel. This is a white linen robe, and it's typical of the garment the high priest would wear as he served God at the temple. Now, it's a white robe. White represents righteousness. But we've already seen that there is none righteous, no, not one. Fact of the matter is, the only righteous man that's ever lived is the God-man, Christ Jesus the Lord. But not only that, being white and being the garment of the high priest, it speaks then of a righteous high priest. Go back into the book of Hebrews, and you'll see a discussion there of our great high priest who came after the order of Melchizedek. And he's telling us of none other than Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. Year after year after year, my father would gather his household around his dining room table, don his kittel, cover his head either with a white yarmulke or more traditionally, a white mitre. And he would lead us through the Passover in full representation of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, our righteous high priest, if you will. But never one time in all my father's life did he ever understand this. Sundown, the 14th of the month of Nisan, we begin to take our places around the table. Mother's going to step out of character now. Mother's going to light these candles. Now, she's the only one who can. But still in doing so, she's stepping out of character. You see, in Orthodox Judaism, women have no public role. If this were an Orthodox synagogue tonight, you would never be seated as you are. Men and women never publicly worship, publicly pray together. Ladies, you're too great a distraction. And the rabbis want our minds on God, not on you. So y'all are removed along with your daughters, usually to a balcony. But then there's some barrier separating you from the public worship. My sisters to this day can remember sitting in those balconies with this lattice work separating them from the public worship. Remember I told you three times a year, the men and the boys came to temple, not the ladies, not their daughters. Still, when it comes time to lighting these candles, mother's the only one who can. I remember my mother would cover her head, light these candles, make some passes with her hands over the candles, and then she'd cover her face. Because what she's going to do is somewhat shameful. There's a man at the table, she's going to openly pray. And she would say, Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kiddushanu v'mitzvotav v'tzivanu alecha lifnei shel Pesach. Blessed be, O God, King of the universe, who hath exalted us above all people and hath brought us to kindle the Passover light. Now with this, mother has brought light to our feast, which otherwise would be in darkness. So think with me. Our God in his infinite ability could have brought the light of this world into this world of darkness through any means imaginable, couldn't he? Truth is, he chose a pretty unimaginable means, didn't he? He chose to bring that light into this world of darkness through a woman, through a virgin, just as a woman is the only one who can bring light to our feast, which otherwise would be in darkness. With that being done, Father takes the first cup of wine. It's known as the cup of sanctification. With this cup, he's going to pronounce his blessing on all the preparations made thus far for the feast. He'd raise that cup and pray, Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, Bray Priyagafen, and then he'd drink. Father will take the matzah now and place them in the individual compartments of the matzah tash. You remember that matzah? It's flat because it has no leaven. It's striped from the cooking grid. It's pierced with holes. It's perfect in every way. Father now will reach in and specifically find and remove not the first, not the third, but specifically the second loaf of matzah. He'll remove that second loaf of matzah. He'll break it. He'll take that broken portion, wrap it in that white linen napkin that's been provided for this purpose, and then still, now in the terminology of my people, he buries it for 3 of the 4 cups of wine. He'll put it under the table cover, under a seat cushion in some homes. Father will hide it somewhere where the children don't know where he's going to hide it, and then they'll go look for it later, kind of like maybe the genesis of the Easter egg hunt, maybe. And so it will remain there until the end of the feast. It's going to be the last thing that we're going to eat. It's known as the aphikomen. It's a Greek word which means the last thing that we're going to eat, okay? I just like that too much. But anyhow, with that being done, then the youngest child at the table, able to read, asks Father 4 specific questions. The questions simply are, why is this night different from all other nights? On this night, we eat only unleavened bread. Why is that? Why is this night different from all other nights? And this night, we eat only bitter herbs. Why is that? Why is this night different from all other nights? And this night we recline in our chair at the table as no other night of the year. Why is that? And why is this night different from all other nights? And this night we dip twice, a cup of salt water here for that purpose. Why do we do that? Father now takes a Haggadah, and he spends a large portion of the evening answering these 4 questions in great detail. Now the reason the youngest child at the table, able to read, will ask the questions is that that gave my father the opportunity, one by one, as each of his children learned to read, right there at his own dining room table in the privacy of his own home, to personally and individually indoctrinate his children in the tenets of his faith. Now, we went to Hebrew school, we went to synagogue, but my father understood it was not the rabbi's responsibility, nor was it the Hebrew school teacher's responsibility to raise his children. He knew that he and he alone stood accountable before God for his household. And fellas, in modern-day Christianity, it's high time we grabbed hold of this. I mean, we have long come to the place where we are all too content to dump Junior off with anybody and everybody who will take him off our hands. We drop him off with the Sunday school teacher, children's church worker, the youth director, the Christian school teacher. Then we walk away just as happy as though we had a brain in our head. We've just deposited our most cherished possession, have we not? Into the hands of people who, for the most part, are total strangers, who now have control of our child's mind and with that the ability to destroy their lives. And we haven't cared enough to sit down with these people for 10 minutes and find out what they're all about. If you think that's oversold, when's the last time you've had your child or your grandchild's Sunday school teacher at your dining room table? See, the problem, Dad, is what we're not teaching, we're not studying. We're dumbing down. Junior now comes in with questions about what he presumes to be his dad's faith and can't get an answer. Instead, gets an attitude. Hey, what are you coming to me for? Am I some kind of preacher? Have I been to Bible college? Don't we send you to Sunday school? Don't we pay all that money for you to be in that Christian school? Go bother those people. Leave me alone. Without ever even having heard the word, Junior has learned hypocrisy. And that's why our kids, never mind the world's kids, our kids. Come on, we need to stop being so alarmed that sinners sin. Folks, that's what sinners do. We need to start being alarmed that our kids are twisting off. And they're doing it younger every year, and they're going out and chasing the sin that's in this sick world in which we live, because in far too many cases, they're finding that to be more honorable than what's going on in their own home. And Dad, it's high time we stepped up and made some changes. You're saying, why are you dumping this on Dad's shoulders? We're the head of the house, aren't we? Which has nothing to do with what just flashed across some of your eyes. Being head of the house has nothing to do with you coming home, flopping down that lazy boy and barking out orders. Change that channel. Quiet those kids down. Where's my iced tea? When's dinner going to be ready? Woman, don't you know I'm the head of this house? Let me tell you something, guys. By the time you give that little thing, you ain't. You know what it means to be the head of the house? Listen, fellas, this is huge. But I believe our wife and our children ought to be able to expect this. I know our God does. Fellas, being head of the house means we walk with Jesus Christ to such a degree that we can lead our wife and our children in the things of God to such a level that they could stand before the Bema Seat judgment of Jesus Christ and give the best account possible. Now, that's a huge responsibility and a far cry from how Ephesians 5 has been exploited all this time, and it's time we stepped up and made some changes. See, my daddy didn't take this by chance. You're saying, yeah, right. Your daddy did such a grand job with you. Then how'd you twist off become this Baptist preacher? Well, it's a good question. I'm glad you brought it up. You see, in a setting just like this, my daddy taught me God. He taught me Messiah. And he did it so thoroughly and so clearly that March 9th, 1969, I'm seated at the Fundamental Baptist Temple in Detroit, Michigan, listening to Louis Hanner preach Christ, and it hit me. Everything he's telling me about Jesus, everything my daddy ever taught me about Messiah. There's no conflict between those testaments, folks. From Genesis to Revelation, it is one plan of salvation to everyone that will believe, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. My daddy literally prepared me for the day that I'd get saved. Now, he'd roll over in his grave right now to know that, but that's still the truth. Dad, that's what we need to be doing in the lives of our kids, but on purpose, not by accident. Simple answer to these questions, we eat only unleavened bread because we're representing righteousness, holiness, purity. We eat only bitter herbs because we're recalling how bitter that time of slavery was. We recline in our chair at the table. We're no longer slaves. We can relax. We can celebrate. And we dip. Remember when Jesus was in that upper room and he declared to those 12 men one of them would betray him? Have you ever noticed every one of those 12 men was frightened it might be him? There's a murmur that went up in that room. Is it me? Is it me? Peter's pushing on John. Ask him if it's me. So how did Jesus identify his betrayer? He that dips his sop with me is he that betrays me. While you're reading that, this is what was going on. Of course, my daddy would never tell me that story. So he'd have us take some parsley, and he would tell us of that first Passover night, how our ancestors fled Egypt very quickly. Pharaoh changed his mind, mounted his armies, pursued after them, and they came to the Red Sea. Let's just settle this one while I'm here, okay? It really was the Red Sea. And a guy in Amarillo, he came up to me afterwards years ago, and he was so proud of himself. He said, now, wait a minute, I've studied this. I said, well, study it some more. He said, but I got into it deep. I said, you're in over your head. He said, but the reed seed would only be 2 inches of water at that time. It'd be easier for them to get across. I said, nowhere in the Word of God does it say they march across in 2 inches of water, hip deep in mud. And more would be the miracle, because that would mean that God drowned Pharaoh and his army and all those horses. Takes more faith for me to believe that thing than it does to let God be God and take him at his word. They came to the Red Sea. God parted the waters of the Red Sea. They marched across on dry ground. Pharaoh and his army pursued them into the dry seabed. God closed the walls of water in on them, drowned him and his army and all the horses. So we would take the parsley, dip it one time for in the salt water, and we dip it once for Israel, once for Pharaoh and his army, and it's once, twice, down the hatch with Pharaoh and his army. We won't be bothered with them anymore. So Father now takes the Haggadah, and he spends a large portion of the evening answering these four questions. He's going to tell us of the hardships. He's going to tell us how our ancestors were forced to build the cities for the pagan pharaohs, how they had to make their own brick, make their own mortar to do this. So we would eat a mixture called charoset. It's really the only thing on that plate you'll want to eat. Apples, honey, cinnamon, chopped up pecans or walnuts. But it kind of looks like the mortar holding the brick together. And by eating this, we enter into that experience with our ancestors and can better appreciate what they must have endured during that awful period of time. Father continues through the Haggadah, and he tells us how that for 430 years our ancestors were enslaved, beaten, brutalized, dying at the hands of the taskmaster. Not even ruled over by the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob at this point, but by the pagan pharaohs. Finally, after 430 years of this, they cried out before God, pled for deliverance, and they wept before him. So we would eat some horseradish. I always am amazed. You got people that raise their babies on jalapeno peppers and you're squeamish about horseradish. But literally, we're trying to bring tears to our eyes that we should suffer a little bit with our ancestors who suffered so at the hands of these pagans. Now, Father can go through the Haggadah from front to back, never really ever have to deal with this. This is supposed to be an egg. It's supposed to be roasted rock hard such that you can't eat it. Mine is a rock. I wanted to be so authentic the first time I put this together. 1984, Michelle came home one day and said, what do you have in the oven? I said, an egg. So what are you doing? I said, I'm roasting it. She said, you can't do that. I said, the book says I need a roasted egg. She said, that can't be done. I said, but, and it went boom. Boy, I hate it when she's right. So after she cleaned the second egg out of her oven, she brought this home one day and said, here, dummy, use this. I've been using it ever since. But it's all right. You're not supposed to be able to eat it. It's supposed to be roasted so hard, it's absolutely inedible. It serves no purpose. It supports no type. It's inscribed on every Seder plate to be there, but it doesn't seem to have any meaning. There are those that say, well, it's here, let's force some meaning onto it. There are probably as many meanings for this as there are rabbis. This is just a little bit of paganism, folks, that's found its way into one of our holiest feasts of the year, just as it's crept its way into our celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and has no place in either celebration. You remember I told you in the beginning we don't celebrate Easter. You know, for some of you, that's about all you've been thinking about since I made that statement, but the fact is the word Easter appears but one time in all the Word of God. It's in the book of Acts. It's a direct reference to the pagan Babylonian goddess of fertility whose name is Ishtar. Easter is a derivation of the name Ishtar. Spring is fertile season. The fertile symbol is the egg, the fertile animal, the bunny rabbit. Now, you want to keep my people confused about the gospel? You keep representing bunny rabbits laying eggs. They'll never catch on to that one. Personally, I can never figure out how you got a chocolate bunny rabbit to lay a caramel egg in the first place. But they told me it depended on what you fed the bunny rabbit. This is just paganism, pure and simple. The night before first fruits, the priests would descend the Temple Mount. They'd come to a field already selected for this purpose, bind some wreaths of barley, go back to the temple. They'd return the next night on the Feast of First Fruits. And in very elaborate fashion, they'd harvest those wreaths of barley they bound the night before. Take that barley corn back to the temple, roast that barley corn over an open fire on metal pans that were perforated so the fire could reach it. They take that roasted barley corn, grind it into a flour, run that flour through a succession of 13 different sieves, each one finer than the one before. They're left now with an extremely fine flour. They take a portion of that flour, mix it with a portion of oil, make a lump, cast that lump on the altar, rises up a sweet-smelling savor to God. Now, when God honors this first fruit offering, he's not honoring just the first fruit, but the entirety of the harvest. So watch Jesus now on resurrection morning, and he will not allow Mary to touch him. I can see him doing this, touch me not, for I have not yet ascended to my Father which is in heaven. He could not allow Mary, having sinful hands, to touch him, and in that risk tainting the sacrifice before he'd had the opportunity to ascend to the Father, transgress that veil, enter that Holy of Holies, that throne room of God in heaven, and play the role of the high priest on our behalf by presenting the blood of his sacrifice upon that mercy seat. You know, it's one thing for a sacrifice to have been made. It's a whole other issue for it to be acceptable before our holy and righteous God. Ask Cain how this works. A week later, he's challenging Thomas to touch him. Why is it okay now? Obviously, in the week that ensued, he had ascended to the Father. He had played the role of the high priest on our behalf, and now there's no risk of tainting the sacrifice. But what I need you to see is that when God the Father honored Jesus as the first fruit of the resurrection, he's not honoring just the first fruit, but the entirety of the resurrection. Folks, that's us. This is where our hope comes. If he's the first fruit, that means there's much more fruit that will follow. And you just can't get something as deeply spiritual as that by insisting on representing it in such pagan terms as this. But there it is. It's taken root in both celebrations. We seem to be powerless to get rid of it neither. How much better off would we be had we done what God told us to do in both Testaments? Drive the inhabitants of the land out from before you in the old. Come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing in the new. There it is. And unfortunately, it looks like there it'll stay. Father now comes to the place in the Haggadah where he tells us of that first Passover night, how our ancestors were instructed by God through Moses and Aaron. They were to take a very special lamb, the firstborn male of the flock without spot or blemish. They were to sacrifice that lamb. They were to apply the blood then to the doorpost and to the lintel. They were then to go into that house, and if you've never seen it in these terms, under the blood, because God was coming to Egypt this night. Now listen, there's no such thing as a death angel. Search your Bibles, you're just going to find them. That's just Hollywood not able to deal with the realities of our living God. See, my generation back in the 60s discovered God is love. Now we won't let him be anything else. But he's first and foremost holy, holy, holy. And the demands of his holiness are so great, if he were not love to balance that out, there'd be no hope for any of us. But just because he's love, it does not negate his ability to exercise his hand of judgment, wrath, or correction. He does not need an agent to do this on his behalf. He's perfectly capable of doing this himself. Go back into the book of Exodus, chapter 12, I think it's verse 15. All the personal pronouns are in the first person singular. This is God himself declaring what he personally intended to do this night. I will come to Egypt this night. When I see the blood, I will pass over. That's where we get the name of the feast. When I don't see the blood, I will enter and I will take the firstborn son of every household. Flip over now to the gospel record and watch Jesus as he's approaching the River Jordan where John is baptizing. John lifts up his eyes, and I think for the first time in his life, he sets sight on Jesus. And what does he declare? Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Every Jewish mind listening to that flips back to Exodus, knows exactly what John has just declared about Jesus. Go a little deeper into the gospel record. Now we see Jesus on the cross, bleeding and dying in your place and in mine, the just for the unjust. Caiaphas still not happy. You know, some people you're just never going to please. They come to Pilate, you need to speed this thing up. It's a preparation of the feast. It's unlawful for any man to hang upon the tree during the feast. He couldn't have cared less about violating the law. You can't imagine how much law he violated just getting Jesus to the cross. What he was concerned about is, depending on the constitution of the individual, you could last 36 to 72 hours on that cross before you died. There are those on record who haven't been taken off the cross alive after this period of time. Caiaphas just wasn't willing to risk this. And so he pressures Pilate, who knuckles under, you know, again, and he sends his soldiers to break the legs of the victims on the crosses. What they would do is they would balance themselves on that nail in their feet, push up on that nail, pull up on the nails in their hands, take the weight off their lungs so they could breathe. They came to the thief on his one side and they broke his legs. He could no longer perform this exercise. He'd slump over and he'd suffocate and he'd die. They came to the thief on his other side and they broke his legs. And he suffocated and he died. But thank God in heaven, when they got to that middle cross where my Savior was, he who always is in control of the circumstances of his existence, who boldly declared, no man takes my life, I lay down freely that I might take it again. And they got to that middle cross and found Jesus had already commended his spirit to the Father, hung his head, and had given up the ghost, and they found he was already dead, and they did not break his legs. And I can't tell you how thrilled I am God includes this little tidbit in the biblical record. Because listen, friend, if ever there was a question that they may have broken Jesus' legs, the critics would have an argument we could not contend with. They would then want to tell us that in order for Jesus to be our Passover, to be our atonement, it was needful that he fulfill the type of the sacrificial lamb in the Old Testament, which means he had to bleed and die, not suffocate and die. And if there's any question that they may have broken his legs, they'd say, see, he failed. And we'd have no Savior. And they'd be right. But thank God in heaven, just as the prophets declared, not a bone in his body was broken. Now, we have to represent that Lamb of God that was slain for our deliverance. In Orthodox homes, we don't even eat lamb at Passover. Don't have the temple, can't sacrifice, so we don't have the lamb. We have to represent it. And of all portions of that Lamb of God to use, we use this. A shank bone of lamb, leg bone. And specifically, it must be an unbroken shank bone of a lamb. What do you suppose this is all about? What clear representation of Yeshua HaMashiach could we hope for? And there it is on every table, on every Seder plate, year after year after year. Father now comes to the second cup of wine. This is known as the cup of judgment. Nobody drinks from this cup. I mean, heaven forbid any should, right? Instead, in a very solemn fashion, Father will go before each of us around the table, one by one. He'll stand before us. He'll take our plates, and he'll begin to recite those 10 plagues. With every plague that he calls out, he drops a drop of wine. Water to blood, a drop of wine. Frogs, a drop of wine. All the way to the death of the firstborn son, and with every plague, a drop of wine. He'll continue around the table till each of us had personally and individually experienced this. Now, I wonder if you're grasping this object lesson. You're a young child. You're seated at your father's table. Over and over and over again, you're listening to that judgment hand of God being exercised against those that would dare disobey him. While you're listening, you're looking at those drops of wine glistening off that plate in front of you, and it teaches you a little bit of what the Bible means when it tells us it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Well, with that being done, we'd have been at the table for like 2 hours. All we'd have had to eat is this lovely stuff. It's supposed to be a feast. We're supposed to enjoy ourselves. So Mom and my sisters get up and go in the kitchen, bring out the feast, anything kosher, but again, no lamb. And we're going to sit at the table now till midnight and celebrate this feast. And it's a lot like Thanksgiving. All the family's home. We're all around the table. We're celebrating God's blessings, showing him our gratitude. You know, in both these celebrations, we've chosen a pretty odd way to show gratitude, haven't we? Because in both of these, the way we've decided to show our gratitude to this God for all the wonderful things he's done, we're going to eat ourselves under the table. I have no idea how that shows gratitude, but I'm for it, all right? Let's not monkey with a good thing. You know? So, as we approach midnight and the third cup of wine, the children look and see that we've eaten everything that Mom has prepared, and we are coming to that third cup. So there's this rush to that place where Father buried that broken loaf of matzah. You remember in the beginning, Father reached in and very specifically found and removed not the first, not the third, but that second loaf of matzah. That matzah that was free from leaven, striped, pierced, perfect in every way, broke it, wrapped it in white linen, buried it for 3 of the 4 cups of wine. We're coming to the third cup. This is now being redeemed back to the table. The reason the children rush to get to it, the one that gets to it first, gets to present it to Father. Father has to redeem it with silver. Father takes this, unwraps it, blesses it, breaks it. We all partake of it. He takes a third cup of wine, which my people refer to as the cup of redemption, blesses it. We all partake of it. And this is where Jesus institutes what we know to be the Lord's Supper. Matthew 26, Jesus is in that upper room. He now has this broken loaf of matzah in his hand that's just been redeemed to the table. What does he say? Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. Not the first person, nor the third person, but eternally the second person of the Godhead. Take, eat, this is my body. Look, there's no leaven. He who knew no sin became sin for you and for me, that we might be made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus the Lord. This is my body. Look, it's striped. They took a cat of nine tails and they mercilessly beat my Savior. Isaiah 53 tells us he was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. That has nothing to do with our physical healing whatsoever. It has only to do with healing. The breach exists between you and God and all of mankind, that began in the Garden of Eden when Adam fell to sin and continued until Jesus bore those stripes in his body and carried our sins away on the cross. It's pierced with holes. They pierced his brow with that crown of thorns, pierced his hands, his feet with those Roman spikes, drove that spear into his side. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus came and they begged the body of Jesus from the cross to prepare him for burial, the Bible says, after the manner of the Jews. Now, first of all, you got to understand, why was it so urgent for them to plead for to take the body off the cross? Those that were crucified by Rome, those bodies now belong to Rome. And they would leave them on the cross to be a deterrent to anybody that passes by. This could be you. And they'd leave them on those crosses till literally the birds and the scavenger animals had picked the bones clean. That was not going to happen to my Savior. So Joseph of Arimathea came and Nicodemus came, and they were indeed successful, and they begged the body of Jesus from the cross, and they prepared him for burial after the manner of the Jews. So what does that look like? This is a gesture of love and an act of worship. This was a sickening sight to even look upon, much less handle with your hands. Isaiah tells us his visage was marred more than any man, such that we could tell that he was neither man nor beast. And still, in a very hands-on way, the first thing they did, they cleansed his body of all of his wounds. It's a gesture of love. Then they anointed that body with about 100 pounds of ointment, wrapped him in white linen. That's an act of worship. Laid him in that borrowed tomb. But after 3 days and three nights, he rose again. Now Jesus has this broken loaf of matzah. As we come to the third cup of wine, he has this broken loaf of matzah that's just been redeemed to the table, and he declares, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you." And he blessed it. Blessing's not recorded, but that's okay. My people still only have one blessing over bread. He raised that bread toward heaven and declared, "Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam hamotzi lechem min haaretz." Blessed be, O God, King of the universe, who bringeth forth bread from the earth. What is he saying? I mean, we all know Jesus is the bread of life. When did he, the bread of life, ever come forth from the earth? I mean, he's still in the upper room. He's yet to be betrayed. For those that are still skeptical, you know, Jesus was so politically incorrect, backed himself into a corner he couldn't get out of, wound up going to an early grave. You listen to Jesus in that upper room before he's ever even been betrayed, praising the Father for his own resurrection, who bringeth forth bread from the earth. The Bible says, in like manner also, he took the cup of redemption, my people call it. He raised that cup and said, "This is the New Testament in my blood, drink ye all of it." And he blessed it. Again, the blessing's not recorded. It simply would have been, "Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam b'rei pri hagafen." Blessed be, O God, King of the universe, who bringeth forth the fruit of the vine. So now what is he saying? John 15, Jesus looks at his disciples. "I'm the vine, ye are the branches. My Father's the husbandman. If you abide in me, and I abide in you, the same shall bring forth fruit, much fruit, more fruit." Those 12 men, minus Judas, adding in Matthias later, 13th, the Apostle Paul, go out commissioned by Jesus himself to preach the gospel to every living creature throughout the known world. By Acts 17, they must have been successful. And now they're heralded as men who've turned the world upside down for the gospel of Christ. And I would say to you tonight, more than 2,000 years after the fact, all the way over here in Arizona City, Arizona, you and I that know Jesus as our personal Savior are literally fruit of those very branches. But it goes beyond that. This has to do with the wedding custom of Jesus' day. You see, in Jesus' day, when a young man looked to marry, he did not do what we do. Our custom is, when a young man looks to marry, he drains his parents' bank accounts, trying to convince some poor unsuspecting gal he's a pretty good guy, she ought to spend the rest of her life with him. What she never understands until it's too late, as soon as she says, "I do," mom and dad cuts off that flow of money, she's stuck with just him. I know it's a mean custom, but it is highly effective. They didn't do that in Jesus' day. In Jesus' day, when a young man looked to marry, he'd go to the place where women would gather, the marketplace, the river, the well. He'd pick out a bride, and then he'd follow her home. Can't do that today. We have laws against this called stalking. You'll probably go to jail. But things were different in Jesus' day. She lived with her daddy until she would marry. She'd go home to her father's house. The young man would come to the door. The father would come out. They'd bargain. They would dicker for the price that that father required that young man to pay in order to purchase that daughter to be his bride. If they came to an agreement, the young man paid the contract price on the spot. He would not be taken into the house. And in most instances, he's going to be introduced to his bride for the first time in his life. If she's in agreement with this wedding contract, she joins him in a cup of wine. Now they're betrothed. The wedding will take place at a later date. If she's not in agreement, she rejects this cup of wine. There's no betrothal. Certainly there'll be no wedding. But listen, that contract price has already been paid. Having joined him in that cup, now they're betrothed, he leaves her father's house and doesn't take her with him. He just instructs her to prepare herself for her wedding day, and neither of these two know when that will be. He goes home to his father's house, and he begins to build a wedding chamber. He provides a wedding garment for his bride. Now, even though he's paid the contract price and is performing all this labor, it's not his decision as to when the wedding takes place. The house belongs to his father. He makes the call. One day when everything meets with his father's approval, he'll tell his son to go get his bride. He leaves his father's house in the middle of the night. He brings his best friend with him. And they can't just barge in here in the middle of the night unannounced. So his best friend blasts a trumpet. They steal his bride away in the middle of the night. They take her home to the father's house. They go into that wedding chamber. That chamber door closes. Outside that door will stand his best friend. In that wedding chamber, that bride gives an account of her life to her bridegroom. When that accounting is concluded, and believe me, to that bridegroom's satisfaction, that bridegroom then will robe his bride in the wedding garment clean and white that he's provided for her. When that's been accomplished, he'll announce it to his best friend, who turns and announces it to the father of the bridegroom, who turns and announces it to his guests. When that announcement is made, this chamber door opens. Out will come this grand processional. They'll take their seats at the father's table, and for 7 days they'll celebrate the marriage feast. And you ought to be ahead of me. Some 2,000 years ago, the Son of the living God came to this old world, laid down the purchase price, and bought a bride. He left her father's house, didn't take us with him. He just warned us to watch and pray and not to be ashamed at his appearing. He, in turn, went home to his father's house and began to build that wedding chamber. John chapter 14, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go now to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. They came to Jesus. When is this going to happen? When will you bring in the kingdom? What did he tell them? It's not for you to know. It's not for me to know. Only the Father in heaven knows. It's his house. He makes the call. One day, and friend, listen, I believe it could be tonight. Father's going to tell the son to go get his bride. He'll leave his father's house in the middle of the night. He brings his best friend with him, John the Baptist. Well, you can't prove me wrong, you know. Gabriel comes along to blast the trumpet. Paul tells the church at Thessalonica, he descends in the clouds in the sky. At the last trump, there's a mighty shout. The dead in Christ rise first. We which are alive and remain are caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. We will never be separated from him again. We'll be taken home to the Father's house. We'll go into that wedding chamber. The door will close. Outside that door will stand John the Baptist. In this wedding chamber, we, the bride of Christ, give an account of our life to our bridegroom. It's called the Bema Seat Judgment of Jesus Christ. When that's been accomplished, and believe me, to his satisfaction, our Savior, our bridegroom, robes us in the wedding garment clean and white that he's provided for us. We are not going to strut the streets of glory, folks, clad in our own righteousness. Not going to happen. Only in that of our Savior, our bridegroom, Jesus Christ. When that's been accomplished, he'll announce it to John. John chapter 3. Get past verse 16. Have you ever noticed there's a bunch of other verses in that chapter? Later in the chapter, down around verse 26, 29, somewhere around there, they came to John and wanting to know if he was Messiah. Guess what he tells him? He that hath the bride is a bridegroom. But the friend stands, longing to hear the bridegroom's voice. This my joy therefore is fulfilled. I mean, of all manners in which John could have chosen to respond to this, why is he using this scenario? Sure seems to me John's plugging himself in right here, doesn't it? Now we get to heaven. This not John, you take it up with him. He started it. He'll turn and announce it to the father of the bridegroom, God the Father, who turns and announces it to his guests, the Old Testament saints of God. Saved the same way you and I are saved. The only difference is they were saved looking forward to a promise that had yet to come. You and I are saved looking back on a promise that already has come. But it's all in the name, it's all in the blood, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. When that announcement is made, this chamber door opens. Out comes this grand processional, and I'm praying each and every one of you will be part of it. We'll take our seats at the Father's table. And for 7 years, will celebrate the marriage supper of the Lamb. While on this earth will ensue the worst period of man's history, the seven-year tribulation. Now, there's one last piece of this custom. At the end of those 7 days, that young bridegroom removes himself from his father's table, takes his bride, and leaves his father's house. Guess what Revelation 19 tells us? The end of those 7 years, our bridegroom pushes away from the table, mounts his white horse. We who are robed in garments clean and white mount our white horses behind him. We follow our bridegroom out of heaven to this earth, where he binds Satan in chains in the bottomless pit, establishes his millennial kingdom, and you and I will rule and reign alongside of him 1,000 years. Man, what a honeymoon, right? The sign of it is a cup. Every bit as much as when you went through the waters of baptism, you identified in the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So it is, friends, come Sunday when you approach the Lord's table and you take this cup, you're identifying with your bridegroom. He's gone away for a while, but you know of certainty he's coming, and he's coming soon to take you home to be with him and will never be separated from him again. Therefore, Jesus tells us, as oft as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we do show forth his death until he comes. And in this, he gave us what we know to be the Lord's Supper. Now, I don't believe he took the fourth cup. The fourth cup is a cup of praise. It has to do with the prophet coming, declaring Messiah had come. That had long since come and gone. But the thing is, you remember when Jesus put that third cup down, he said, I'll not taste of the fruit of the vine of this cup again until I take it with you anew when I come into my Father's kingdom. So I don't believe he took the fourth cup. So at midnight now they sang a hymn. They departed the upper room. They walked by the corner of the Temple Mount, crossed the brook Kidron, into the Mount of Olives, to the Garden of Gethsemane, where he'd be betrayed that night. But it's midnight now. All of us kids would get up and run to the front door. We'd throw the front door open, fully expecting the prophet to be there to declare to us Messiah had come. You know, year after year after year, he never was there. Can you imagine our disappointment? I mean, we only expect this one night a year. Our expectations are at a fevered pitch. And again, it doesn't happen. We close the door. We're a little saddened by this. We make our way back to the dining room. Father changes the mood from sad to glad just by declaring next year and in Jerusalem. Well, now we get happy again. Look, he didn't come last year. He didn't come this year. Surely he'll come next year. And hopefully we'll all be in Jerusalem when he does. So we'd start to sing. And we'd sing joyfully. One of the songs we'd like to sing, Father would call the plagues out one by one. And we'd sing, he'd call out water to blood, and we'd sing, die, die, Anu, die, die, Anu, die, die, Anu, die, Anu, die, Anu, die, Anu, die, die, Anu, die, die, Anu, die, die, Anu, die, Anu, die, Anu, which means enough, enough, it should have been enough. Frogs, enough, enough, it should have been enough. All the way till we got to the death of the firstborn son. Then very solemnly we'd sing, die, die, Anu. Die, die, Anu. Die, die, Anu. Die, Anu, die, Anu. Enough, enough. It was enough. Listen, friends, just as the death of the firstborn son was enough to deliver my people from their bondage in Egypt, so it is. The death of the firstborn son of Almighty God was, is, and shall forever be enough to deliver all of mankind, to deliver you here, now, tonight, from your bondage of sin. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Sure, the wages of sin is death, but, don't you love it when God butts in? But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ the Lord. Everything I've shown you tonight has shown you Jesus in every possible way you could hope to see him. And all roots out of Exodus 12. I mean, how much more do I have to tell you? How much deeper in the Hebrew Scriptures need I take you before you'll begin to realize that there never has been, never will be another plan in the mind of God for the forgiveness of your sin and the salvation of your soul and for that of all mankind that ever had or ever would live, save the shedding of that innocent blood of that spotless Lamb of God on Calvary's tree. So what are you going to do with what you know tonight? Are you under the blood? Come on, stop playing church for a minute. We get so good at that. We come service after service after service, trying to convince these people we're something we're not. They're going to wind up in heaven. You're going to wind up in hell. Wow, you sure fooled them. Come on, knock it off. This is the most critical issue in your eternal existence. This one, you want to get right. Make certain. Make absolutely certain before you leave this building tonight that you've had that encounter with Jesus. That you've acknowledged your sin for what it is. How it alienates you from this holy and righteous God. And nothing you could do could change that because it'd all be tainted by sinful hands. You needed one greater than you, and you needed one that was sinless. And you see Jesus, the eternal second person of the Godhead, coming to this earth, taking on human form, walking this earth for some 34 years, tempted and tried and never one time sinning, going to the cross sinless, bled and died in your place, went in the heart of the earth and rose again. And you see him there at the right hand of the Father, and you cried out to him and pled his blood to cleanse you of your sin. Opened your heart, invited him in to save your soul. If you haven't had an encounter with Jesus that mirrors this, you need to come and get saved tonight. There is no other way. But you that are saved, what are you going to do with what you know tonight? What? Trust in Jesus. That's great. That took care of you. Is that it? How are your friends, your neighbors, your relatives, people you work with, rub shoulders with every day of your life? How are they going to get to heaven? Well, preacher, you made that perfectly clear. The only way they can is the blood of Jesus. Well, that's my point. When are you going to start telling them? It's not my job. Why do you think we have this preacher? Sheep make sheep. Shepherds don't make sheep. Not his responsibility all by himself to win every soul to Jesus in this community. And it's not going to happen. And it's not because he wouldn't love to. God never intended it. You're rubbing shoulders with people he'll never meet. Why aren't you telling them about your Savior? And you can throw all the excuses away. There's only one reason for it. We have long come to the place we care more for their favor than we do their soul. We want these people to like us. We're just not willing to risk making them mad by telling them about Jesus and losing their friendship. Can I tell you? That's an awful high price for them to have to pay to be our friend. They should spend eternity in hell so we can play with them for a little while on earth. Come on, folks. These are eternal souls hanging in the balance between heaven and hell. We have what they desperately need. How dare we keep hiding it from them? Paul told the church at Corinth, if our gospel be hid, it be hid to those that are lost. We need to stop hiding Jesus. Can I put it this way? We need to stop acting like we're ashamed of him. We were in the restaurant for lunch today, and there was a big long table, a bunch of ladies at this table. And they stopped when their food came. They all bowed their head, and one of them prayed. Jim Whisper. She prayed loud enough we could hear her. And I told the preacher, I said, I'm on the road 200 nights a year. I eat in a lot of restaurants. Do you know how seldom I see that? Even on Sunday after the morning service, when it's a church crowd, I so seldom ever see that. Come on, folks. We need to stop living like we're ashamed of Jesus. If he really was the most important thing in our lives, he ought not be that tough to talk about. We ought to be like all these grandparents we have here tonight. And my day's coming, and I keep pushing my daughter. She just got married a little over a year ago, and I just keep pushing for those grandbabies while I'm young enough to be able to play with them. And I'm going to be the worst one that there is. People are going to see me come in the door and run. For all the pictures I'm going to want to they've seen the pictures 10 times. But I'll be so proud of that grandbaby. You know how it is, right? You just keep showing the same pictures. You know, we're so proud of them like we had anything to do with it. And we had nothing to do with it. Why can't we be that way with Jesus? Isn't Jesus more important to us than those grandbabies? And why can't we talk about them? People ought to know where we stand. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. It doesn't say, let the lost of the world wonder. Wonder where you stand. They need to know we stand with Jesus. You don't have to be belligerent about it. You don't have to be ugly and caustic about it. You can do it in a good way where they can respect what you say. But they've got to hear it. What if the person that witnessed to you the day you got saved was no more faithful with his witness than you are with yours? Would you ever have heard about Jesus? Would you even be saved tonight? That's the question we got to ask ourselves. It's time to pay back, folks. Somebody took that risk with us. We need to take that risk with others and just go tell them about our Savior. Then what are you going to do with what you know tonight where my people are concerned? They're desperately dependent on you for a gospel witness. Will they get one? Go home and read Romans 9, 10, 11. You'll see God's passion for his people played out in the Apostle Paul. Paul says in Romans 9, verse 3, that he was in such continual sorrow of heart that he would wish himself accursed from Christ if it would mean salvation for his kinsmen after the flesh, Israel. Chapter 10 and verse 1, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And in verse 14, when he asks the questions, he's still talking about Israel. He hasn't changed the focus. How then shall they? Who would that be? The same people group that he's been talking about, that his heart is broken for, and all of chapter 9 and 10 to this point. It could easily have said, how then shall the Jews, how then shall Israel, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? Call on him in whom they have not believed. And how shall they believe on him in whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear except one preach? And how shall he preach except he be sent? Verse 17, so then faith cometh by hearing, but hearing of the word of God. You know what all this means? Paul's saying, I'm so brokenhearted for my people. If it were possible, I'd give up my own salvation, spend eternity in hell. If that mean all the Jews of the world be saved because of that. So where's a passion like that come from, if not from God? I constantly beg God that they would be saved. I know if they'll just ask, Jesus will save them. But how are they going to do that? They don't believe in him because they haven't heard. And how will they ever hear except people like you send people like me to them with a gospel witness? Chapter 11, verse 30 and 31, he clearly now lays the responsibility on your shoulders. Remember, he's talking to non-Jewish believers at Rome when he says, by their disbelief, you obtain mercy. Salvation is of the Jew, came through the Jew to you, you got saved, you ought to be thrilled with that. Now he says it's time to reciprocate. So it is then by your mercy, they shall obtain mercy. It's come full circle, folks. And it is a holy expectation of our righteous God that you who have the gospel see that his people have a hearing of the gospel. And he promises he'll bless you if you'll do it. Genesis 12:3 is still valid, folks. I'll bless them that bless thee. You can be no greater blessing to Abraham's seed than to provide them a gospel witness and in that the ability to be saved. I will curse them that curse thee. You can be no greater curse than to withhold that gospel witness and in that consign them to an eternity in a devil's hell. So blessing, curse from God. Which would you prefer? I really hope you're not mulling this over. This should be a no-brainer, folks. And the beauty of it, to be blessed in this arena, all you have to do is give them that gospel witness. Get the message. Get those words into their ears. Give the Holy Spirit something to work with. What are you going to do with what you've heard tonight and what you know tonight where your own eternal soul is concerned, where that of those in your circle of influence are concerned, where my people are concerned? Let's stand. Every head bowed. Every eye closed. I appreciate your